He came silent. His blonde coat was ghostly as he lumbered my way.
Underneath those power lines to keep the trees from growing up in their lines, and then as a result it's pretty thick under there, and rabbits and other small game live under the high lines. And where you find a long stretch of high line, perfect place to get close to it, there's gonna be coyotes hunting. So the coyote comes along and he gets a whiff where he sees where he buries it, and then he goes steals the fox's catch. They're thieves. They're dirty thieves. And
the predators who roam the night have intrigued me for many decades. And before the trail camera, I was puzzled at their ways and blind to their nocturnal characteristics. That has changed. Join me as I hone my skills at catching him as he travels beneath the light of the moon. Learning his way and knowing the truth to the elusive nature of this cunning prey.
So, we're gonna set this trap and I'll try and prove to you that this is a method that works.
The dirt hole set has been used for much longer than I've been alive. Though a common trick known by most seasoned trappers, we will still visit its lethal edge with never before seen footage of the catch.
Got the bait in the hole. We're ready to rock and roll. Now, let's see who takes the bait tonight. Because when they do, they're gonna get slocked.
I've been trapping for nearly 40 years, and I got to thinking I was pretty good at it for a while, until I put trail cameras on my sets, and then I realized just how bad I was. Most of the coyotes that came by the set would either take a whiff and run or not even look over at my set. That's when I decided I needed to come up with some kind of sound device and change the game.
The next 24 hours, we'll have a coyote in this set. All right, let's see what happens.
That night, the trap hunted to no avail. But two doors down, my guests have arrived.
This is the second coyote we've caught in this spot on a dirt hole set. Pretty good.
Pretty good.
All right, wash your hands off. Or drag him around here, get some odor. So when you catch a coyote, you can throw him in the back of your truck and whatever set you go to, take him with you and drag him all over the place. Get all that urine and everything on the ground and double your odds.
With the trap reset, my odds of a catch are now exponentially higher than before. The first dog to appear smells the odor of his slain comrade and wisely moves on. The longer he tarries, the greater his danger becomes. Still, methodically, he scans the scene for clues to danger. If I've left a clue or the slightest odor at the set, he will find it. Yet the pungent smell of the earlier catch lures him closer to his doom. And at last, he is mine.
I'm having the time of my life. Give me a blowgun and send me in the woods, and I'm as happy as a little kid in a candy store.
Ha ha!
Well, if you're a trapper, you know what this is all about.
Yep,
it's that time of year. I'm about ready to get after them. Trapping season. And if you love turkeys and you love your upland game, rabbits and quail and your whitetail fawns, you know that to bring a balance, we got to reduce the coyote population. But anyway, got my traps out, dipped them in wax and stained them. It's not really necessary to stain your trap, especially because it's going to be under the dirt where they can't see it. But I stained them anyway. My grandpa taught me to do that and been doing it ever since. But I use the kill squeak, as most of you know, that little green call that catches them, lures them in, but I've come up with a new idea as well. And this is my kill chirp. And Tom Miranda has helped me with this, developing this call. You're not gonna beat the kill chirp or the kill squeak. You just hide those in the brush, you put your bird up in the tree where the coyotes and bobcats can see him, and there's no strategy to it, really. You just hide your trap underneath him out in front of it a little bit, and they walk right in and get caught.
In the wee hours of the morning, the beast have arrived. One recognizes it's a trap, but the other is not so wise. At first, he straddles the trap. And somehow, avoids death. But eventually, death will smile on us all. And tonight was the coyote's time.
If you talk to a lot of trappers, they'll tell you that the longer the trap sets, if it hasn't been rained on or frozen or anything like that, the greater the success. That's just because they smell you when they first get there. But if you use dead downwind, this stuff, I've used a lot of different sprays, and I used to use dead downwind when I was younger, and I've come back to it because it's the best. I douse the entire trap as well. So once you do that, you can hit your gloves and everything, and pretty much eliminates all the scent on the site. And you just spray down your site, and that will make it a lot less difficult. Just pulled up, got a nice catch. He's a filthy mess because it's been snowing all night and he wallowed in the mud. I'll check the camera, but he's pretty lively. This is a double catch. He's caught on both feet. I can live by these double sets on coyotes. You got a dirt hole set, and if you set one out in the danger zone where they're a little suspicious of the set and they trot back and forth, you're talking 7 feet out in front of your set, it's a good odds you're gonna catch him in that one first, but I might have got him in the dirt hole. I'll take either one. I gotta clean this dog up, but he looks like he's got a pretty good hide. Pretty good morning, first trap I've checked. You can see where he came in the night, last night. And when the ground's wet like this, mat it down with your boot or your hand, if you're wearing rubber gloves, then take the leaves all around it and mash them into the ground all around your trap, right, before you cover your pan. All right. Just the way I like it. Okay, so we got a soupy, sloppy mess. Here's the dirt hole over here where he got caught. Caught him in the front leg there, off the dirt hole. And then I caught him on the hind leg out here. I haven't watched the video yet to see which leg got first, but either way, he got slocked. There he is. Real feathers too, boys. If you don't think that an animal can tell real feathers from a fake plastic one, believe me, they can. And I even added a little string on there for you to hang from a tree. And you just put that in the brush so when that dude's walking by and
He sees that, it's better than anything else you can hang, and here's why. Because when you turn it on, let the music play, boys, let the music play. Right here you can see, here's a little on and off switch on the bottom of him. Just turn it on when you get it right out of the box. If you haven't caught anything by then and the battery's run out, you just take it, open the bottom of the bird like that, replace your batteries, triple A's, they're not expensive, nothing special. Just snap her back together, turn her on, the beautiful little decoy. And it works, trust me. It's making trapping easier. Trapping's hard enough, especially if you're trying to catch bobcats and coyotes. Raccoons, not so much, but bobcats and coyotes, they're tough for all of us. But any angle we can get to increase our luck, you might as well do it. So this is a good way to catch them. So, all right, let's get into this and get after another bobcat or maybe a gray fox, because I did some hunting in the south and had a lot of luck down there in the south and in the east. That's where them gray foxes live, and a lot of bobcats as well. So
when I say south, I mean South Texas, New Mexico, Arizona, Mexico, Southern California, the desert, a wonderland for the predator hunter. And if you're the first one there to call, you will call in exponentially more animals than anywhere else in the country.
Gray fox and bobcats are thick if you know where to find them. And the first to show is a big gray. He cautiously looks things over, then makes his final mistake. Yet another has taken the bait and is closing fast. We have started out the day with a couple good slockings on the gray fox.
And you can see in the far distance, you can see the type of habitat that we're hunting here. It's vast and it goes on for hundreds of miles. All around us, it's fox country. This is also the country of the wild turkey and the quail. And we're bringing a little balance here today, putting a little food on the table and fur.
It's been a good morning.
We had some great fun this morning. Cheston has produced the fox. He's the man, and today's his first day to film. Way to go, Cheston. You my man. Let's check out these foxes. That first one was a beautiful fox. And if you don't believe a grim reaper can knock them down quick, well, there's a testament to it right there for small animals. If you want to use a grim reaper on them, it just knocks them right out flat. And I also have my little slockers here. I'm going to test them out today. But we started out the day with the grim reapers because this is bobcat country, and you never know when you might pull one in.
Fox right there. A smaller fox.
Now,
But I do want to show you the value of a Grim Reaper if you need to stop animals quickly. And you can see that it's very effective. So, beautiful fox. He was just about going to, I let him stay around the call too long and he about got away on me. This guy here, this is a big old male. Justin, come over here. Look at this fox. Isn't he a beautiful fox?
Yeah.
Wow. What a beautiful creature. God must have had the old paintbrush out for a long time before he put us on the earth, because I mean, it's just amazing some of the beautiful creatures that we get to hunt and get the opportunity in the Southwest. I mean, look at the bobcats and the spots on them, mountain lions. We got caracara birds flying over us every time you turn on the call.
they just, I mean, you can almost watch the caracaras and know where the graves are coming from.
Yeah.
I mean, it's crazy.
Okay, where we head to next?
We'll go get some more.
Let's go. I'm all about it.
He stares at the fox pro. I'm hoping he'll come a bit closer. But he is wise. The fox is leery, so he holds behind cover. He knows that any time a coyote or even lion could come his way. And eventually he backs off. But I fool the fox with a mouse squeak. He can't resist.
Hot country down here. The hotter the climate where you hunt, the thinner their fur will be. But I've noticed that the hotter it is, the more brilliant their their colors are. But anyhow, they have a brilliant color in the south. The coyotes are the same way. But anyway, we've got a beautiful fox. He's not a real big guy, but they don't get big down here in the south. And it's a male, so. Let's trudge on and see if we can call in Bigfoot. Who knows? You never know what's coming in down here. Finally, I have seen him, and he comes my way. I have outfoxed the fox. Wow, that was an exciting set. had four foxes come in, three males and a female. I killed two of the males. Perfect surroundings, you just see. It's a long ways from the nearest road though. You gotta sweat to get here, but once you do, you're in prime country for foxes. You never know, you could call a bobcat, but it's primarily gray foxes. This one here is a beautiful one.
I always got my 22 Magnum in the back of the truck, and when I'm driving around and when I'm checking my traps, especially in the winter when there's snow on the ground, light skiff the snow. If I see fresh tracks in the snow, you know, I'll park the truck, grab the Fox Pro, jump out, head down in the timber, you know, try to anticipate where that coyote went and call him in and kill him. Hop back in the truck, go set some more traps or go check some more traps. And that's a good way to do it.
I'm talking to an angry pack, a pack of males who are trying to breed a female. I am lying, and they believe. Although they have heard the gunfire, the remaining two still want to believe I am a coyote. The temptation is strong. For this young male, it was too strong.
Let's play a little music and see who wants to dance.
I didn't jump in the tree, but he sure made a fatal mistake with that smoke right here down through the brush.
About 15 yards right in front of me. He came hobbling around that corner, came right in my slock zone right there. I was gonna shoot him when he first came around the corner, but he was acting so stupid. I was like, I'm gonna let him come all the way right up against me. He got in here close enough I could smell his breath. Nailed him. Let's go see if we can find that coyote.
Can't beat it. It's a good time, good fun with a bow and arrow. It's really hard, but if you pay attention to the wind, you set your call right. You always want to set your call like 50 yards. That's about my effective range on a predator. If get him within 50 yards, I can kill him. So if it's a bobcat and he comes to my call, or a gray fox and he comes straight to it, you know, I got him. But if a coyote's swinging downwind and he's running or something, for example, I went to Mexico and called in and killed three or four on one set. I'll play that for you. But that call is upwind to me, almost 50 yards. And those coyotes, when they come to me, they're swinging downwind to that call. But still, I'm far enough that they're not completely behind me. They're right in front of me. And I was picking them off one after another. Those are just the ones we got on film. Once in a while, I'd swing behind me or something would go wrong with the camera. I killed a lot on that trip.
And I killed them all using that technique. It works pretty good.
And in no time, they come to dance. The pack has arrived, but made a fatal mistake. As many as are in front of the camera are behind it as well. I have killed the alpha. Now the second in line stands over his dead body, maneuvering back and forth. He then decides to skirt the call. It's a fatal mistake.
Insane. I was being attacked from every angle. Best I could tell, I called in about 8 coyotes. It's time to start looking for dead coyotes and arrows. I don't think I brought enough arrows today. Wow.
All right, let's play a little music and see who wants to dance.
This guy didn't jump in the tree, but he sure made a fatal mistake in that smoke right here down through the brush.
The Mexican coyote often hunts in packs, large packs. And I have wandered into a big one. Two are already dead, and more are coming my way. When bow hunting coyotes, if you're hoping for a nice easy shot, you can forget it. This is about as easy as it gets. And if you're a bow hunter, face the truth. Sometimes you're gonna miss.
Some days it works and some days it don't. And today it is dynamite. They're hungry and coming to the call. But this guy here came right in here. And I missed him at 15 yards. I shot right between his legs. But man, that is so exciting. Wearing them out. They're out here hunting deer, and we're hunting them.
The spore is everywhere I look. So I gathered my arrows, then gathered the dead.
For all you boys out there that say, I don't eat coyotes, come here, I want to show you. Is it done?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, looky there. Oh, you even got the tongue sticking out. Look at that, guys. Look at that.